All right, so we continue our point-and-click adventure, the choose-your-own adventure sort of game. At the end here, what we've got is we went from scene 4, where there was the hallway. Scene 4, we had the painting that doesn't do anything, but it could be set up that once you interact with the painting, something else happens. But we'll get to that later. And then I put a clickable hotspot to go to the right hallway, and then that takes us over to scene 5, hallway right, where we simply made it, okay, as soon as you come here, you die. Question?
No, I still have problems with opening it up for the publisher.
Opening it or saving it? Because it gets weird. The first time...
Publishing.
Yeah, do a save as. Do a file save as and save it with like a number 2, and then that'll kind of fix it, and then it should be published.
How do you change the name of your scene, say, forgot about that?
Can you go up to right here with the name? Can you go to scene? Mm-hmm. Put it in your phone.
So we went from scene 4 to scene 5, and we died right away. Now, actually, the idea is if you play the game, you come to this scene, and there's another hallway. I'm standing in a place, and I can go straight ahead to a door straight ahead. There's a couple of doors on the side. The thing about the way I designed the example game is that you get tricked on that screen that you think you can do something. But no, what happens is then some monster comes out from the furthest door and comes at you. And basically there's no way around it. I didn't program it for you to be able to get past that screen, but you obviously could. So the idea is we come to this screen, we think we can go into a door, but a monster comes out and we're so terrified we can't run away and we die. Obviously you can make it do other things. So this is not quite the dead screen yet. There is going to be a separate scene, good ending, bad ending. So this is still one more scene before we go to the final death scene. So here, whatever I had here, I'm going to delete it. And instead, I'm going to draw a hallway. I know a hallway where I'm looking toward it. At the far end, there is a door. And then there's other doors on the hallway. So I'll get my brush tool, and I'll show you what I mean here. I'm going to draw in perspective. There's a hallway that's going off over there. There's a door over here.
So we're changing the hallway properties?
Properties? Nope. You're drawing a hallway. Question. S5 hallway, yes.
Okay.
Instead of having that dead screen right away, we're changing it to be one more hallway screen.
Hallway right.
Okay, so a moment ago it was simply you're dead. That was just a placeholder because we ran out of time last time. We're going to draw a hallway. We step into this hallway because on the previous screen we were able to choose left and right. I went to the right. So we're on hallway right. I look straight ahead, down the hallway, there's a door. To the left and right, there's also doors. Should probably be on the left side. None of these will be clickable. None of these will let you go anywhere else. The whole point of this is just a screen that tricks you that you think you can do something. But you could. Let's say you knock down the painting and there's a key. You can use the key in the door. We haven't talked about that yet. We might do it later. So let's draw a hallway. What this screen will be what this screen will have is that the at the end of the hallway, you know, a person comes in and they try to click a few of these because that's what they would be expecting, but then a monster comes from the end of the hallway and just keeps coming at him relentlessly. And we're so terrified we can't escape, we die. So let's say that maybe about a second after the person comes to the screen, They try to do something a second later. That's when the monster comes. So the that means there's going to be a pause for about 1 second. Let's go to frame 25 of the assets layer and press F5. So the doors will, the screen will look like that for 1 second. And then past that, the monster appears. So I'll make a new layer called monster. I'm going to lock the assets layer, which is the hallway. And I'm going to have a new monster layer. So press F7 on frame 25 of the monster layer and draw a monster. As cute and cuddly as you want. So on the monster layer, I'm going to draw a monster on frame 25. So on frame 25, you need an F7. The monster is coming from the end of the hallway, so first I'll draw it small, and then it'll come at us. Now obviously we can set this up that it's going to walk or crawl or whatever. You'll figure that out eventually. Maybe I'll just do a very, very simple kind of ghost monster thing. So brush tool. Going to draw a monster on its own layer. That I will turn into a symbol. I'm turning it into a symbol so that I can animate and I can tween it, because I want it to go from the end of the hallway right up to my face, and I'm dead. So that's going to need to be a symbol so that we can tween it. So I'm going to draw it. I'm going to press F8 to turn it into a symbol. We can call it whatever, MC Ghost, MC Death, whatever yours is. And I'm filling in its color. Okay, so I drew the monster, turned it into a symbol. I'm going to draw a super simple, I'm going to make it animated, super simple. In its own symbol, I can make some basic animation. So when I double click it to edit the symbol, I'm then going to have the mouth open and close or something. Or the eyes twirl around or something. I'm going to have it have some kind of animation. So I'm going to edit the symbol. Now one thing that's confusing, of course, is, well, what timeline am I editing? What object am I editing? That's things that you'll need to get used to tracking and keeping track of. I'm editing the symbol of the ghost, not the actual main timeline, of course. those mistakes can be fixed, but they're tricky sometimes. So make sure you're editing what you should be editing. I'm editing the ghost, and it tells me there on the top left, I'm inside of the ghost symbol, which is inside of the hallway scene. I'm editing the ghost symbol. I'll do some simple animation here. First frame, the mouth is open. Two frames later, F6, I'll draw the mouth a little different. So first I'll erase that mouth and then draw a different mouth. Maybe turn on onion skinning so I can see it. Two frames later, F6, and then I'll draw again the mouth a little different. So something super simple. I've got, you know, three frames of animation where the mouth is moving. Obviously, you can make it more complex. You should make it more complex at a certain point. So, Kyle and Jacob, do you need any help there at the moment?
No, we don't. Thank you.
So, the mouth is opening and closing. It's in its own movie clip. And therefore, it's gonna animate on its own when it's on the main timeline. That's one of the great things about also a movie clip. You can have it do its own animation. Like, what about a flickering flame? I can create a symbol called torch and then animate it inside of its timeline that it's flickering. And because it's a symbol, then I can copy it two times to have a torch on the left and a torch on the right, and they're both gonna flicker. Here, because I've created an MC ghost, I can use the same ghost character throughout my project, and it automatically has the same animation. Maybe this character will appear more than once. So I've drawn it, I've animated it, I'm going to put it into my scene where I'm going to shrink it so that it's on the far edge of the room, of the screen.
Have them appear in like a picture or something.
Well, yeah, if you draw a picture, have him appear in the picture. On mine, he's going to come from the door. So, frame 25, and probably I'll go to at least frame 100, probably 125, and then press F6 to do a tween so that it starts small and then it gets big at about frame 125. So I'll go over to frame 125 on the monster layer F6 and on the assets layer F5. F5 on the assets so that the hallway suddenly doesn't disappear, and F6 so that we have a different keyframe so that then I can increase the size of the ghost and move it toward us. We'll probably have to do it more or less. We'll figure it out. The more frames we have, the slower it'll come at us. If we have less frames, the faster. So we can figure it out. But the ghost is small on frame 25, the ghost is big on 125, and in between, we will do right-click, create classic tween. So what happens there is the ghost is coming at us. I can, of course, have all of these you know, animations to polish it. Maybe the door should open. Maybe the ghost should materialize. Maybe the ghost should come up from beneath the floor. You have those possibilities that you can do, of course. Together we're creating this basic idea, and then you'll be extrapolating it and making it your own. The mouth is going to animate after you actually publish it or control enter. The mouth doesn't animate if you just do an enter. So at runtime is when it actually animates. Just to check it out, I'm going to do control enter to run it in my emulator. No, this one's a classic tween. So I'll activate touch layer, go past start, open the gate, toss the rock, go to the right hallway. I'm trying to click on the door to go to the next spot. Oh, we have a stop animation there. We have a stop animation, so we shouldn't have that because it stopped it and the ghost never comes. Not a stop animation, a stop command.
Should we create a motion tween or a tween?
Try one and see what happens, but it should be a classic tween. So my stop animation, my stop code, that is, it's not, I don't want it to stop yet. I don't want it to stop on frame one. I want it to stop after the ghost gets to us. So on the actions layer, on frame 150, F7, monster layer F5, and assets F5. That's where the stop should be. We had stop on frame 1 before because that's where we ended on Wednesday. But what I actually want is it to animate for the ghost to come at me, and then stop when it's right at me, which will be frame 150. That's where we want to stop. So if I start, open the gate, throw the rock, move to the right. There's the first second where I'm trying to click, and then whoops, here he's coming at me. And that's where it stops. Now, here's where we would then figure out the actual death scene and all of that, but that's the point of the right hallway. It looks like you're going to be able to proceed, but then suddenly the ghost appears. So let's make sure that works. Anyone need any help with that? You've got little animation, you've got a hallway, the ghost comes at you, and then it stops at that point, and then we'll add some code.
First, I mean,
So did everyone get that ghost moving at you? Okay, so the point here is that after the ghost comes at you, this is when you actually die. So this room doesn't let you do very much, but a ghost appears. We're then going to have a brand new scene, which is looking a little bit ahead, but eventually the ending of the game is either going to be good ending, bad ending. Or you could have multiples, of course, if you want to figure that out. So we're going to need good ending, bad ending. You know, scene 6, bad ending, or whatever. But I'm probably going to have different scenes before the good and the bad ending. So I'm going to go, obviously, I'm going to go with scene 10, bad ending, scene 11, good ending. And in the middle, we'll figure out the scenes in between. The names don't quite matter unless you're consistent. My point here is that after the ghost comes at you, after that frame 150, here we'll have the usual, then go to and play, scene 10, bad ending. And the bad ending is the one where it's okay, you are totally dead, play again. So right now we haven't really done much navigation of going forward, going back into rooms. That's something that you can figure out. But at the least here, okay, we're dead. It'll take us to the dead scene. Open up your code, and we're going to, after your stop command on frame 150, we're going to get the code that lets us move from scene to scene. So from any of the previous scenes where you have that, scene 1, for example, line 12, this is one of the spots where that code is at. Scene 0, I mean, frame 1. This go to and play. That's what I want, which I'll copy from scene 1 and paste it into my current scene 5. We need to change it. All of it is good except for where we go. Scene 10, bad. So then I need to create a scene, 10, bad, where there's something that says, you're dead, game over, try again. And then we'll make a button to take us back to the beginning.
Is this frame 150?
Yep, what does my screen say? Okay, so that means we need a scene 10. Create a new scene and we'll call it scene 10, bad. And on this scene, we'll have something that says game over. We'll have two buttons, play again or exit. So play again will take us back to the very first frame, very first scene, and exit will quit the app. We have both of those abilities. So, assets layer. I'm going to draw whatever you want to show that this is a game over screen. And then we'll have a button for play again. Each of these then needs to be a symbol. So you're going to select your quit, turn it into a symbol, fill in the color. Turn that one into a symbol, fill in the color. We need an instance name for each one. And then we'll write the code. So I'm turning the quit into mcquit, and then the play again, f8, turning it into mcplay again. And then, very important, we need the instance names. So play again mc, and quit mc. So making buttons, again, we've got a symbol, they've got a name, they've got an instance. Pretty soon we'll get to the part. We'll get to the part about adding music. Once we set up the navigation to go from screen to screen, then we can go back and add music. We can add different soundtracks to different scenes. So a nice sad song could play here. We'll have sound effects for when you click on things, like when you click on the gate. We'll have it play a sound effect of a creaking door. When the monster appears, the ghost will have a sound effect of it growling and such. So we'll get to sound, but still working on navigation. Okay, so I've got all of these elements. They've got instance names. I need a new layer for actions. We need a stop, first of all, so that the movie doesn't play, so that the game doesn't play automatically. This is frame one, frame one of your actions layer. Okay, so we need let's do the quit one first, that it quits the app completely. Then we'll do the one to go back to play again. So we have quit underscore mc dot add event listener. Open and close parentheses. Touch event. This is another one that you can copy it from elsewhere. Tap. This one be function go exit. If you click the quit button, it'll run the function to exit the whole game. Now let's call it go quit, just so that we are consistent with these names. We can call these whatever we want, but it makes sense. I'm going to quit when you click the quit button. If it was an exit button, then it would be function exit. Function go quit, parentheses, curly braces. The details are that this is an event, touch event, colon void. So we've done this a bunch of times before. You could have copied it from elsewhere and then just changed it. So when the person clicks the quit button, here's one new line of code, so I'll make a comment actually. Code that quits the app on the person's device. This one's a new line of code. Native, capital N. Application, capital A. Dot native, lowercase. Application, uppercase. Dot exit, parentheses, 0. That line of code lets the person completely exit the game. We've been in the game this whole time, and if the person themselves clicked their home button to get out of the game, that's one thing. But now we've programmed it in the game, now we have a way for the person in the game to quit the game. It's this command, it's just the way it is. We're saying on the native application object, so the whole app, we have another command, native application, exit. We have other ones, other things that we can do, but exit is one of the basic ones. So the point of this one is, I'm done playing, I've died too many times, I'm gonna exit. This bad screen, now that we've got the bad screen, you can figure out how many other ways I can get to it. Because you've played games and there's various ways to accidentally die, and they all go to the same end screen. So once we've got this scene 10 bad, you can get to it from any other screen. You'll need some event handler. Let's say you're on scene 20 and somehow you die. That scene 20 will have a way to go to this scene as well, where they can choose to play again or exit. The other possibility that we have here is to play again. Playing again would take us back to the first scene, the home scene. We could have it that it goes back to the very first home scene, or to the first game scene. Remember, scene 0 is the home scene that tells you the game, and then there's a play button or a help button. You could have it go there. Or you can have it go directly to scene 1, the gate. It's up to you. But we need the same sort of thing, an event listener for that. We have play again, underscore MC. Yes, I'm going to copy it. I don't want to type all of that. Play again MC, and then the rest is the same, touch tap, etc. Function go play again. Next line, I'm going to create a function. I'll copy the one at the top. Don't forget the ending curly brace. So we're going to click to play again. It'll do the play again function. That'll be play again. And then we'll do the rest. Hopefully you're getting it that you need event listeners to things that you click on to do something. The something is the function. And so far it's been about navigation, going from screen to screen. We're going to have these functions also play music eventually. Then we're going to have this function when we go to the left hallway. We're going to have a function now do a little bit of randomness. If you played the game, you saw that you get to a screen where you try to open the wrong door and spikes start to come out of the walls. You have 3 chances to open the right door before the spikes get you. So that's going to be a little bit of logic, a conditional statement. If you're trying to open the wrong door, spikes. If you're trying to open another wrong door, spikes. If you open the right door, no spikes, and you go forward and you live. But everyone was pretty much dying. I guess it was too much bad luck in the game. So that'll come for the left hallway.
Unless it's Dark Souls.
Yes, the most unluckiest game. So what we want here is the code to go back to the scene 0. I'm going to go back to find my code, back on scene 0 to copy that. Paste it. Scene 0, home. So those are the two buttons on this screen. Person thinks that they have 3 more doors to go into. Nope, as soon as you go to the right, it's basically a game over screen. After the animation of the ghost, you get to the bad ending. And from the bad ending, you choose start over or quit. Save it and run it and see if it works. And if it doesn't, call us over. do a publish on mine so that I can see it on a real device. I'll put my code back up in just a moment. Or you can check Discord.
Yes. Because sometimes switching between screens, especially since you've got code on different keyframes, and like two different students need two different keyframes.
Yes.
Yeah.
Send me the duplicate function definition.
When you did a copy and paste, you have to remember to change the function you copied. If you copied this function and put it here, it should not be go quit anymore. It should be go play again. Try to run that and see if it works. Check if you get errors. Did you figure out that duplicate function?
Oh, no, no, no.
Trouble? So again, you can ignore that APK successful sort of thing. But I'm on my device. I go to start, I open the gate. I throw the rock. I go to the right. I'm thinking of opening a door. Whoops, then the ghost is coming at me, chomping at me. And then at a certain point, then it's fully dead. I play again, I have quit. If I do play again this time, it takes you back to the first screen to start or to help. I'll go through it one more time, and this time I will go to the quit, and what should happen is the whole game exits. So try that one more time. Here comes the ghost at me. Again, I can animate that faster, I can do other things, I can make the screen turn blood red. You have all of this possibility. Then I'll do quit. Click on quit, and it exits right back to my device's home. That's what it should do so far. Anyone need any help with that? Yes, sorry. Here is the code so far.
Angie, whenever my thing compiles, and if it's like something is in the way, you can close it if I'm not there to close it.
Okay. Alright, so the hallway right is a dead end, basically. It does this, takes you to the bad end. Let's then back up and then create a left hallway. Now, what I kind of liked to do on mine is I borrowed the same drawing of the hallway from the right side and I put it on the left side. I just maybe flipped it over. So you can redraw the left hallway if you want, or you can copy the right hallway. We're going to copy the layer. The layer of assets is the drawing of the hallway. So in the hallway right, I'm going to copy the assets layer. Hallway right, right click assets, copy layer. That copies the whole drawing. We'll create a new layer, or a new scene. We'll call it Scene 6, Hallway Left. And then I'll right-click and paste the layer.
So that brings back the exact same hallway, which you can keep it like that, or change it, or do something else to it. What it also did was it brought in a lot of extra frames. We may or may not need them. We'll see. So on the left hallway, on the left hallway, we have an actions layer. In the actions, this is where it's going to keep track of. Okay, we've got three possibilities. A person may click on one of these three doors, or that one. So let's assume the worst case scenario. The person clicks on the first one, spikes start to appear. I'm gonna have it appear from the left wall and they're gonna go that way. You can have it from below, sure, but then you're gonna get killed faster. So let's say a person tries to open the right door, from the left side spikes appear a little bit. Okay, let me try this one. So they click that one, more spikes. So they have those two possibilities that they waste. And the third one is when they actually exit. So for whatever reason, they click the wrong door too many times and the spikes go all the way across and you get killed. So we're going to have a movie clip that starts off that there's no spikes. They click the wrong door, the movie clip plays a little bit to show spikes. They click another door, the movie plays a little bit more. Spikes. So the way I'll start this is on the assets layer, we're going to draw, no, actually on their own layer. This will be better on its own layer. Let's make a new layer called Spikes.
Is this like a new scene, or is this the same hallway scene?
This is hallway left.
So then I'm going to draw here some very basic little points where the spikes will appear. So some spikes are going to appear through some of these little holes. All of this will be a movie clip. That's why I separated it into its own layer, just so that I can select it easier. So I want to select all of the dots that I just drew, F8, to turn them into a movie clip, and we'll call this MC Spikes. I'm then going to edit the spikes, double click.
Frame one, there's like just little points where they're going to come from. Frame 5, F6, I'll draw them sticking out a little bit more. Frame 10, F6, I'll draw them sticking out more. Frame 15, draw them sticking out more.
So F6. Draw them sticking out a little bit. From those points that I set up, that's where they're going to start to come from. Obviously, if you drew a lot of points, well, you've got a lot of spikes. Hmm. F10, or frame 10, F6, to draw them a little further out. Frame 15, F6, draw them even further out. I guess by this frame, you get stabbed, so it's done. So see, if I do a quick enter here to play it, that's what's going to happen. That as you go into the wrong door and such, it will have these possibilities. You have a few chances to go to the right door before the wrong doors get you. This is going to play automatically, so the movie clip itself needs a stop action. And we need a stop action on each one of the frames where the spikes further protrude. So we need a stop on frame 1 and a stop on 5 and 10 and 15. It's coming out, and we don't want it to just keep playing animating back and forth, the spikes jumping. So we need an actions layer. And on each of those frames, F7 for each of them, so that you can add stop. So we need stop. We need stop on each of the times the spikes have come out a bit more.
The first frame you put stop.
Yeah, the next frame, frame 5, then 10, then 15. One more thing here. This is kind of like the ghost. The ghost is coming at us, and then we see that it got us, and there's a little pause, and then we go to the bad ending. This is very similar here. Instead of the ghost coming at us, there's this animation of spikes coming out. So then we'll jump over a little bit of time later to have the last spikes visible, and then it'll have the go to the bad scene. So I'm going to say frame 50, F5 for the spikes, and F7 for the actions. I need basically the same go to and play for the bad ending that happened on the hallway right. So a quick way, remember, if you're gonna copy and paste your code, you can find the other frames here. You can go to the other frames here. But back on the hallway right, I had the code for that movie clip. That's what I'm going to paste into my spikes. So the left side shows you what frames you have code and what symbols. We need to go to the spikes symbol and frame 50. That's where I'm pasting in the same code as before. Go to and play scene 10 back. We have different ways to get to the bad ending.
What was that? Did you change the names of the layers?
Well, the usual. The usual. We have assets layer and actions.
Oh,
the way it's up on your window menu scenes. Window scene. That lets you change your scenes. Okay, so the way we are going to trigger these spikes is we need to have a counter. This is similar to when did we have a counter before? We had if else. We needed to count. We needed to keep track of something. So we're going to create a counter to then, oh, that was with the painting. When we touched the painting X number of times, eventually the painting fell. So very something very similar to that is what we need here. So what we'll do is we'll go back to frame, we'll go back first of all to your bad scene, and we're going to be in frame one of the bads, not the bad scene, sorry, the left hallway. So we're on the left hallway. We've got the doors. We're going to set ourselves up to count. You touch that one, spikes. You touch that one, more spikes. Does that one? Good. So these are going to need to be clickable, and they're going to make the spikes appear. I'll lock the spikes layer. We need to turn the left and the right doors into symbols. So if you select your left door, or right door, whichever.
If you select the right door, F8, turn it into a symbol. And we'll call it MC wrong door right. And we'll do the left one, MC wrong door left. So each of these will be a symbol to click on. Will take you nowhere, but it will activate the spikes. So MC wrong door right.
And then on the left, MC wrong door left. So both of those doors on the left, and then eventually we'll do the third door. But for the moment, we'll do the left door and the right door. Both of them are wrong. I need to fill in their color so that there's a spot for the person to click on. Without color, then they have to click exactly on the edge of the door. So temporarily, I'm just filling in a white color. Thank you. And I have targets there. I have a couple of doors. They are clickable. We've got instance names. We'll make actions now to make those active, and then to start to make those spikes appear. Back on my actions layer, first we'll stop. So here's your actions layer on the left hallway. We're going to keep track of how many wrong doors they've gone to, so we need here, next line, variable to keep track of going of picking the wrong door. So var door counter colon number equal to 0. This is what's going to help us keep track. Right now, we haven't gone to the wrong door yet, so it's 0. When they click the wrong door, that will increase to 1, and more spikes appear. If they go to the other wrong door, that will increase to 2, more spikes will appear. If they've gone to the wrong door too many times, maybe they click twice, well then that increments faster. And when they're at a certain level, door counter more than 3, all the spikes come out, and the person's dead. Well, the way that works is to start to get these doors to be active. Let me confirm that these have their instance names. Nope, so see, it's very easy to forget. I was going to forget. I named them MC door right, and then I need the instance name. You know, wrong door right, MC. We have MC wrong door right. That's door, that's wrong door, right, underscore MC, for the door on the right, and then I'm going to need the correct name for the one on the left, wrong door left MC. Once I've got those instance names, then we'll add the event listeners as usual, and have it react to a click. Both the right door and the left door have had an instance name added. I'll go back to actions and activate the event listener to trigger the counter. Wrong door right MC dot add event listener. Event.touch tap, comma, f and go wrong. It's going to be the same function, go wrong door. It's going to be the same function for the left and the right doors. We can borrow the same function. The left or the right door are both wrong, therefore, they will both go to the wrong door. So this line, I'm going to just copy it and paste it. Wrong door left. I need the exact same result. I need the exact same result for both doors. The one on the right is wrong, the one on the left is wrong. Only the one in the center is right. So they will both go to the same go wrong door function. They will both add to the counter, which is currently 0. They have not picked a wrong door yet. 0. If they pick a right door, that becomes, door counter becomes 1. If they then click the left door, door counter becomes 2. And if you have 3 wrong doors, spikes, you're dead. So we have that part. Then we need to define the go wrong function next. We can make a comment here. Either door is wrong. Run the function go wrong door function. function go wrong door event touch event. Okay, so either door is wrong. What we need to do then is add one more to the door counter. That's really easy. We'll say add one more to the door counter. That's going to be door counter plus plus. So now 0 is 1. What we also want to happen, spikes underscore mc dot play. The spikes are currently paused before they come out the door. So you went to the wrong door. Make the spikes come out a little bit so it plays from frame 1 to 5 of the spikes movie clip. So the spikes come out a little bit. The person then says, oh, let me try the left door. So go wrong plays again. We add one more, so now I've got 2. And then the spikes movie clip is currently paused at 5. Spikes play, so then it jumps to 10. The spikes come out a little bit more. So it's not quite there yet, but I think we can kind of test it to see if we have any errors so far. So type that and let's test it. And let me confirm your spikes. Oh, there we go. So again, very easy to forget. I made the spikes into a symbol, and I named the symbol, and I was about to forget to give it an instance name. That's what my code there is saying, spikes MC play. I forgot to put that name there, so to my spikes movie clip, spikes underscore MC. Now that that movie clip is named, the code that I just wrote that says spikes MC play will play, because it's named. That code is ultimately saying. You pick the wrong door, increment the counter, and then play the spikes, which I just named. Spikes will go to frame 5 to show you some more spikes to scare you. You click another door, wrong door, counter increments again, spikes play to the next one, 10. Once we confirm this is working, then we'll say if they clicked the wrong door more than 3 times or whatever, 3 is too much, the spikes come out all the way, you're dead, and then we've got go to and play bad ending again. Let me check mine really fast and then we'll confirm that yours works. So again, the more complex you make this, you have to go through your whole game yourself. And if you start to add this randomness that we're about to add in a moment, when you're testing it, when you're beta testing it yourself, you're then going to see these issues. First of all, what's my issue right now? We didn't make a button to go to the left. We made a scene, and it's waiting for us, but we didn't make a button to go to the left frame, the left hallway. So, whoops, okay, we'll go back to the hallway, the main hallway, entryway. We'll go back to the entryway. And we will add some target to be able to click on the left hallway to go to the left hallway. Okay, so let's go back to the entry. We need to go back to the entry, and we need to make a target on the left side. A very quick way to do it is just to copy the one on the right and put it into the left and change its instance name. Hallway left MC. So we hadn't done this. Last week we had made only to go to the right. Now we need to go to the left. I copied this symbol, put it on the left, make very sure that you change its instance name. You cannot have more than one thing have the same instance name. In the code, then, we need to add hallway left MC, add event listener, to go to scene 6, hallway left. Then I can test what I wanted to test. This is what I'm saying about beta testing and how complex you get. Maybe you have an idea to make 20 different screens with a lot of cool interactivity and get this key and put it there and put it that. You're going to have to play test through your own game to further test the further levels of your project. So the actions layer in the entry scene, basically I'm going to copy this chunk here. This lets us go to the right hallway. So copy that, paste it, hallway left, function go hallway left, function go hallway left, go to unplay, scene 6, hallway left. Should make sense. So if you name these things in a sort of consistent manner, then the good thing is that you can figure out what you need to do. So go hallway, left, or right. So we need to copy and paste it first. No one said anything. Minus 10 points.
I was curious why you were.
Okay. I had it selected, but I never copied it and pasted it. There we go. Because I saw two functions, but the first function was for the painting. And I thought, oh, I have them both. No, we need three.
I was thinking you were maybe for alphabetical order, maybe. Mm. That's why.
That would make sense. So F, so S6, hallway left. There it is. So we've got our event listeners for the right door, or the right hallway, and the left hallway. The corresponding functions. Different functions because they do different things. One takes you to the right, one takes you to the left. Sometimes we can reuse the same function if they do the same thing. Like when we're in the left hallway, both of those doors are wrong. So both of those doors could use the same go wrong door function. Got it there. I'm going to save it and test it, and then I'm going to see if the left hallway works. It in my simulator. The best result is on the device, but the simulator works pretty fast. So it starts, I get past the gate, I throw the rock, I have a left way to go. Oops. S6 hallway left. That just means I probably misnamed a couple of things. S6 hallway, look, there it is, lowercase.
Okay, so super subtle mistakes. I had here S6 hallway left, capital left. And when I named my scene, S6 hallway left, lowercase. So some of these, most of these errors seem like weird and scary, and what does it mean?
Well, look at it, and through the gibberish, you'll be able to figure it out, because this looks like a bunch of gibberish, but I'm seeing my very first thing here.
Scene S6, hallway left, was not found. It would be nice that these errors are like, you know, human readable errors that say, you forgot to name your symbol. But this is made by programmers, for programmers. And the thinking about it is a little bit more obtuse. So, that scene is not found. And I'm thinking, of course it's found, I just made it. But I misnamed it uppercase and lowercase. So this is the debugging aspect, the troubleshooting that sometimes is not so straightforward. You have to look at your error that it gives you and try to figure out what it's trying to tell me, go to where it tells me the problem is, and then hopefully figure it out.
Yeah, most of the time with the not found errors, it's a simple typo.
Yeah, exactly. Or that I never named my symbol, my instance, that is. I can't find your hallway left symbol because I never gave it an instance name. That's good that that mistake was there, just to show you that, obviously I make it look so easy, but there are mistakes that happen and we can troubleshoot it. Start, gate, rock, left. There we go. Alright, so because I'm testing it right now, I know that these two doors are active because I drew them.
Eventually, when I finish the project, I'll fill in the colors properly so it's not so obvious that these are clickable.
So, let's say then there's spikes there. I click on the right door.
It was the wrong door. Spikes are starting to appear.
Okay, let me try the left door. Oops, more spikes. Maybe by now the person figures out straight ahead, or they're like, well, maybe the right door now. Click on that, more spikes. And then eventually, well, you click the wrong door too many times, you're dead.
It wasn't supposed to do that, but that's what it did.
Hmm. Interesting. Oh, I know why, because it did jump us to the next one. Okay, yeah. Yeah.
So there's no way to go back to like previous, like, for example, you went to the hallway, right?
There is, but we haven't programmed it.
I mean, it's kind of better because if you just keep pressing doors, you're left with just like one way.
Yeah.
Yeah, usually in games like this, the back button is to push the bottom middle of the screen.
Yeah, down here somewhere.
Alex has hers working where she does have a dedicated back button floating around.
So based on what we've learned, we can set up some sort of trigger to have us go back to the previous screen. Yeah. So wrong door. We need to.
It did kill us, but we need to set it so that after a certain number of protrusions, then we're sure it kills us.
And to make it even more interesting, that could be a random number. It could be that, you know, right now we have it after three wrong clicks, we're dead. We could have it randomly. After one wrong click, we're dead. After seven wrong clicks, we're dead. When I did it on the example game, I guess the random number was too mean to us and everyone was dying. No one was able to go to the right way. But this is the idea. You're going the wrong way and then the doors are going to, the spikes are going to proceed and then they'll kill you. Let's pause there. It's not fully working yet, but do you guys see something? Do you need any help? Are your spikes emerging? Here's the code so far.
Or the screenshots on the Discord also.
Mm-hmm. Okay, so the way that we're going to have this decide if you've gone to the wrong door too many times, still inside of the wrong door function, we're then going to add more here where we start to pick if you've done it too many times. So here's a note. If wrong door is clicked too many times, pick when we die. So inside of the wrong door function, we're going to have a spot if else. We're going to check some possibilities. If you've gone to the wrong door too many times, then play us to the death. Or else, just let the spikes keep emerging. We'll make it easy first, then we will have a defined number. Then we could do a random number. So this if is where we're checking what's the possibility. If door counter is greater than something. So if the spikes have emerged, you know, three times, we're dead. So door counter starts at zero. You click the wrong door once, door counter becomes one. Is one greater than three? No. Else, nothing happens. If you keep clicking at the wrong time, eventually it will have four. Is four greater than three? Yes. So then you've got the scene here where you die. Because we're saying greater than, that doesn't mean the same number. Here, this means greater than 3, so it does not include 3. 1 is less than 3, 2 is less than 3, 3 is not less than 3, 3 equals 3, so it still wouldn't count. It would be 4. 4 is greater than 3, that's when it would count. I want it to count 3 or more, so that's equals, greater than or equals. And the part that is the actual death is inside of the spikes movie clip frame 15. So spikes_mc.play. Actually, frame 10 shows the spikes fully extended. Where does it show it? No, it does show it on 15, yeah. So 15, they're fully extended. And then we're dead. So if the person clicks three or more wrong doors, it jumps us to the 15th frame of the spikes, which then takes us to the death screen. Else then actually doesn't do anything. Because one wrong click, you're fine. Two wrong clicks, you're fine. So this else part would normally have what else happens besides the first possibility. So nothing's really going to happen here, so player is still safe. We could do is have a trace so that in the output panel we see how many times have they clicked on. we will see it as a developer. They won't see it. They don't have an output panel. We have an output panel. Okay, I think at this point we can test it. And now we're saying you have a maximum of 3 chances before you get killed. In a moment we'll do this randomly so that it could be 3 wrong clicks, it could be 1 wrong click, it could be 12 wrong clicks. So we'll see. So I'll do a test on that. Oops, let's see. Incorrect number of arguments. Oh, okay. One little thing. Play plays wherever the movie clip is at. It plays it to... It plays it from that point. I don't want that. I want it to jump to frame 15. So it's not play. Sorry about that. It's go to and play. Play doesn't let you choose which frame to jump to. It just says wherever your current movie clip is at, play it. Actually, we want jump us to a certain frame in our spikes, in this case 15, so go to and play, capital A, capital P, and then frame 15 in the parentheses. So I'll try that one. All right, so I click on the left one. Now also, if you look at your output panel, one appeared. I clicked on the wrong door. Spikes appear. My counter under else tells me I've got one wrong door. Click on the other door. So I'll click on the left door. Spikes emerge a little bit more. I've got a 2. One more chance. For whatever reason, I said, let me try the right door again. I think I didn't open it right. I clicked that. That went on to 3. It went on to the play animation. Should have. Huh. That was close. We might have to just lower our number. So depending on how many chances you want to give the person, you can click the same door more than once. So by that time it should have gone to the death scene. So we were too nice. Instead of greater than or equal to 3, it'd be a 2. So that did it. Now, the amount of time that the spikes are visible on screen, that's another thing that you might want to think about not changing it too long. So guys over there, remember, if you need a little bit of help, a little quieter, please. You're distracting the class and me. So the spikes are visible maybe a little too long. The spikes in the movie clip. So it sort of gives you like what's happening. Nothing's happening. So if you change the length of time on these spikes, right now it's waiting all the way until frame 50. So a person's waiting this long and they're thinking, well, what's going on? So maybe we only need a little bit of time, maybe only up to 30. So if you'd like to, it works, but if you'd like to tweak it a little bit, you can change this to be frame 30 is where the final frames are at in your spikes. So I've made that spikes time a little bit less. I just took away a few frames. And as I test it, I'll see that there's less of a pause when those spikes come out. That's happening with a known quantity. We know that if the person clicks wrong more than twice, it's game over. To make it a little random here, because everything else, every other scene has been pretty defined. You do this, you get that result. When we introduce randomness a little bit, then we have a different kind of perspective on the game. It's not going to be the same game every time. Right now, if a person goes through the project, it's basically the same game, but once we start to introduce randomness, it'll change a little bit. So what we'll do is we'll create a random number, and that random number is going to be here. If door counter is greater than random number, different things will happen. So we have a way to create random numbers. We need a way to create random numbers. So we'll say that as soon as we enter this scene, a random number will be picked. It's predetermined. As soon as we enter the scene, the person has X number of chances. They're not going to know this, but they have X number of chances. We'll make a random number. And then this will say door counter greater than random number, and the rest happens. So before the wrong door function, I guess we can do it also before those event handlers. Let's back up right after. We've got the var, we've got the variable of door counter. After that, let's make something new here. We'll create a function called random numbers. Function to create random numbers. Right now we're creating this function different than before, where we've had a function that was basically used by some trigger, event handler. This was a little different. Nothing is going to trigger it. No click is going to trigger it. It's going to get triggered by getting into this scene. As soon as we come into the scene, give us a random number. We don't have to do the user interaction of clicking something. It'll create a new random number when we walk into the scene. inside of the random numbers parentheses, we're going to say limit number. So this random number can be from 0 to 10,000. We want a limit. I want it between 0 and 3. So we're going to have a limit, which is a number. Give me a random number up to this limit. The result of this, colon number. We had colon void every other time because nothing has to then come back to us after clicking these things. It just does it. Here we do get something back. We get a number, a random number. We have a limit, it'll do some calculation, and we'll get a number back as a result. Inside of the function, we'll create a variable. It the random number. This is a number equal to math.random. So there's a built-in JavaScript code, math.random. This creates a random number. But the problem is it creates a random number between 0 and 1. How many numbers are there between 0 and 1? Infinite. Because half is, you know, 1 half. Half of a half is 1 quarter. Half of a quarter is that. Half, half, half. You can keep making smaller and smaller numbers between 0 and 1. If you never thought about that, there's an infinite, mathematically speaking, there's an infinite number of numbers between 0 and 1. So math.random creates a random number between 0 and 1. But that doesn't make sense. I need a whole number. And I also need to define, between 0 and 2. I don't want between 0 and 2 million. So before I finish the statement, actually, so I'll delete that semicolon. We need to do a little bit more. Math.random times. The times is shift 8, the asterisk. We're going to multiply whatever random number we get by our limit. Parentheses, limit, plus 1. So when we use the random numbers function, we will supply a limit, 6. We're then going to get the random fraction, multiply it plus the limit and add 1. That will make sure that we don't have accidentally make frame 0. We could have a random number of 0. I don't want a 0 number. I already started with 0 on number 4. So limit plus 1. To start us 1 higher than 0. And then again, because we may have still a fraction. It's just the way that it is. When you make a random number, you get a fraction. I want to also round it. We can round it up or we can round it down. So we'll do one more thing here. Wrap parentheses around the whole thing there at the end. Wrap parentheses here, semicolon, end of statement. So think of a random number, multiply it by our limit, plus 1, so we don't get 0. But then all of this will be rounded. So back up here, math.round. Math.round. This will get whatever's in the parentheses. This calculation, this will get it and it'll round it. And rounding it does it like the classic way. If it's more than 5, it rounds up. If it's less than 5, it rounds down. However, that still gives us the possibility that it can be rounded down to 0. So instead of having it choose rounding up or rounding down, we have a way to make sure we round down. Math.floor. Because the floor is down. So this number is going to get rounded down to a whole number. It's going to take away the fraction. It's going to round it down. We will always round it down. If we had a 1.2, it would round down to 1. If we had a 1.8, it would round it down to 1. Math.floor forces it down. If the floor is down, what's up? Ceiling. So we have math.seal, not ceiling, seal. Math.seal will force it to round up. So if we had a 1.8, it would round it up to 2. If we had a 1.5, it would round it up to 2. If we had a 1.1, it would round it up to 2, always. That would be seal. So seal rounds it up no matter what. Floor rounds it down no matter what. And round lets it choose up or down. But I usually want the direction. I want to choose down or up. In our case, we want floor. And then on the next line, return the random number. Make that calculation and then get that number back to us so that we can use it. The way we use it is create a variable as soon as we walk into the scene. This is the function to create it, but we haven't used the function. So after creation of the function, we'll use it. We'll say var door counter random. This is a number. And it's equal to random numbers five. For example, that's too much, but there's five. So we use our random numbers function, which we invented right here. This will make a number basically from 1 to 5. And it'll store that in a variable called doorCounterRandom, which we can then use down here. And that's how we use our random number generator. That's too many numbers. So just to check it out, I'm going to put a 1. Now it's way too mean. You're going to die really easily with a 1. Probably a 2 or a 3 is what we want eventually. But here this creates a random number, stores it. And then we will use the random number right here. If door counter is greater than or equal to door counter random. We had a 2, which means you always have the possibility, you know you're going to die if you click the door more than twice. To make it more interesting for the person to try again, it's going to be random every time they get to that room. So if our counter is greater than or equal to our random counter, we're dead, or else it's not, it's less than, and we live. So we've got a function at the top that makes a random number. We save the random number, line 12. And then we use the random number, line 23. Make sure you change that, or else it's just going to be the same 2 instead of a random number. I have it very low at 1. It'll probably kill me faster, so let me check it. Yeah, so it only took two times. Question? All right, one moment. Okay, so one more little tweak as well. Go to and place 16. I'm forgetting that on frame 15 we've got a stop. So yes, frame 15 shows the fully extended blades, which is what kills you, but then there's a stop there. So if we go one past it, it'll show the fully extended spikes, and it won't get stopped by the stop. So there could be the randomness about one wrong click, and you go right away die. Or else it's not that number, so it'll go to the next one. So let's pause here a little moment. Save it and run it. You should be getting a result. If you're having any trouble, call me over. We'll figure that out.
Thank you. Yeah, but
So that one is, it saves this, it kind of bookmarks it to your so that way you can access it from the app and any other device. And any other computer you can use.
All right, everyone, we're going to wrap up in just a moment. We have one more thing to do. All of this has been about it's getting us to the bad ending. If you went to the right, it's automatically the bad ending. If you open the two wrong doors there, it'll get you to the bad ending. The final good ending is the door right across the hallway. So what we'll do is we need to make the door that's across the hallway a clickable door, and basically that one will just right away, when we click it, will take us to scene 9, good. We have a scene 10, bad, a scene 9, good. Whatever number we want to give it. So let's make the door straight ahead into a symbol. So select your door at the very end. F8 to turn it into a symbol. We will call it MC door right. Or correct. So it's the door, it's the correct door. Because we have MC door wrong left, MC door wrong right. Before I go further, I'm going to give it an instance name. I'm forgetting to add my instance names too, so I want to get used to doing it right away. Turn it into a symbol, and then go to the properties and add your instance name of door. Correct underscore MC. However you spell these things is up to you. If you spell it wrong always, it's not wrong. If you put it all lowercase, it's not wrong. If I put uppercase and mine works, but yours is lowercase and it works, it's fine. It just needs to be consistently the same. You can make everything always lowercase and never have to worry about when is it uppercase or lowercase. But when you look at people's tutorials, online, they usually do it this way. More than one word, you capitalize the other words. The door has been created into a symbol. It's been named as an instance. I'm going to just fill in the color so I have a target to be able to hit. I notice my door is not fully closed, so there it is. That's all I need. I just need a closed shape of a door. It's got an instance name. I'll return back to my actions. Super simple. Door correct MC dot event listener go scene 9 good, and then a final good happy ending where you can play it again or you can exit. So before we get to that, actions, we have all of these of wrong door. To save a little bit of typing, I'm going to copy one of the wrong doors, paste it at the end, and change it to the right, to the correct door. Copy that, go to the very end. The good door ending. This is door correct. MC. Function go correct door. We define then its function, function go correct door void event colon event touch or touch event. Touch event. What happens inside of here is go to and play scene 9, good, which doesn't exist, but we'll create it in a moment. So I'm going to borrow that go to and play from somewhere. Back on scene 0 is a quick way. Scene 10, bad, is the bad ending. I could do scene 11 as the good ending, or scene 9, doesn't matter. These names don't matter unless you're consistent. And so far we've gotten up to scene 10. Well, we've done scene 6 for the hallway, left hallway. So we could do a 7 and an 8 for some other screens, scene 9. So it doesn't matter that we've got a gap between scene 6 and scene 9. Doesn't matter at all, because we're jumping to the different parts of the project however we want. Doesn't matter that there's a gap. You see, so what I'm saying here on our scenes, we've been making all of these scenes sequentially. I didn't know how many extra scenes I had in the middle, so I made a scene 10. Now making a scene 9. Good. Be careful if you want to then rename it. Okay, scene 6, hallway left. Scene 7, good ending. Scene 8, bad ending. You could do that. But if you rename your scenes here, your code does not change. You need to remember to go back to where you had scene 10 and change that to scene 8 if you change it. So if it works, I would leave it as is. If you want to change it to be very consistent and OCD, great, but check all of your code where it was there, and if it's wrong, it'll tell you. And don't freak out if it tells you, because, yeah, you renamed a scene, a target, and your code has not been changed. So there's a good door, I click it, I go to the good scene. I'll make a brand new scene 9 in my scenes panel, draw a happy face or whatever, you win, and then have the button play again, and the button quit. They are different buttons with different instance names, but those two could still use the same functions that I've already defined in the bad scene. So everything needs a unique instance name, but I can reuse functions throughout my code. Okay, so I need a new scene. I need a new scene, so I'll create scene 9 good, S9 good. You win. I have play and quit. I already drew play and quit on the bad scene. I can copy those and paste them here. They will need new instance names and the appropriate code. I'm going to borrow my play and quit buttons from the bad ending. Just copy those. Go back and paste in place. Control V will put them in the center of your screen. Shift Control V will paste them exactly where you took them from so that they're lined up exactly from the other scene. they come in with the same instance names, which we don't want, because every item on screen needs to have its own unique instance name. So simply, play again 2, MC. Quit 2, MC. That's all we really need to differentiate them. So your play button on the good ending, there it is, different enough, number 2. The quit button on your good ending is quit 2, MC. I want to borrow the event handlers from the bad ending. Copy them and paste them into this scene. So from the bad ending, the code there, I have quit MC and play again MC. I just made right now quit 2 MC and play again 2. I'm going to copy this, but you don't need the functions. You don't need to create function go quit 2. That's a waste. You can reuse the same go quit. Even though it's in a different frame and a different scene, it's smart enough to keep track of all of your code. And on that other scene, we will be able to access it. So from the bad scene, I'm going to borrow the quit MC and paste it into my good scene. I need a stop action first. Quit 2 and play again 2. I don't need to recreate these. I don't need to do go quit 2 and go play again 2. I don't need that. I will reuse the previous ones that are created in the other scene. And these are new instances. So I get to the good ending, and it's basically play again or start over. Again, obviously, when you have your time, we'll probably spend 2 weeks on you doing your version of it. And then you'll turn in your version, but there's still a little bit more to learn, like music and such. We have enough of the building blocks to be able to navigate from screen to screen and do a little bit of randomness, picking up objects and doing that sort of thing. And maybe by popular demand, if people say, well, can we do this, can we do that? Maybe we'll vote on things and we'll figure it out and that sort of thing. But I want at least the basic of it to work. Let me confirm mine does. So I'll test it. So I start the gate, the rock, left. I know not to click on the ones on the left. I'll just go straight ahead. Click on that. You win. Play again. Goes back to the start. I'm going to skip those negative doors again and just go straight again. I win. And then quit. The whole game is quit. So I did not have to redefine those quitting and play again functions. I'm just reusing them. At this point, we're done for the day. I'm going to put my code into the network folder if you want all of my code. Check that your code works. Call us over for help. Check the Discord. When we come back next time, we're going to start to add sound. This game is suddenly going to be a lot better with a background music, music via interaction. So when I open the gate, I want a nice creaking sound. When I get stabbed up with the spikes, I want a nice slicing sound. I have some of those sounds for you, actually. So I'm going to save all of that to the network folder right now, and you can get a copy of them, and we'll do a little lab time.